Hello, Internet. I'm David, and this is the Pursuit Blog. And this is a video in response to Prof. MTH's response to my video, which was called A Logical Rant Against People's Illogical Logic on Jesus. And in Prof. MTH's response video, he takes about 10 minutes to dissect what I said. So this is my response to his video. First, you have to understand the target audience that I had for my initial video. The video was targeted toward people who call themselves Christians but really don't believe anything about Christianity or the Bible, to which the theme of the video was go do some research and actually understand what it is the Bible is saying. By no means was my video supposed to be this perfectly exegetical work on the divinity of Jesus, but that their logic on the fact that the Bible is untrue is very illogical. Now, Prof. MTH, I'm sure I'm screwing up your name. You may not believe what I believe, and that's okay, but I'd at least like you to hear me out in my logic. First, I have to commend you on your history. You're right, Christianity was spread greatly through the Roman Empire because of the Emperor Constantine becoming a Christian. But you have to wonder what the state of Christianity was that the emperor thought that it would be politically good for him to become a Christian. Because either he did see a vision, which I don't know if that's true or not, or that he thought it was politically savvy for him to become a Christian. So this group of people that was being persecuted or just left alone was growing to the point that it was expedient for him to do so. And my question was, how in the world could this religion grow to such the extent that it was growing if it wasn't built on some amount of truth? Now, we can argue on how much truth it was, but you cannot deny that it was established on some amount of truth. I think most religions are built off of some amount of truth, unless they're written by a fiction writer, Scientology. Now, you may not believe in the miraculous that is found within the Bible. I understand that. But trying to disprove the Bible using the Bible, I believe, is illogical. Now, I watched your video, and I looked up in my Bible all of your citations that you used. Now, I applaud you for the fact that you did take to heart what I said. I said, go and research these things. And that was the point of my video, to which many people missed, unfortunately. And I applaud you that you went and you did the research. Unfortunately, I do believe your exegesis and your interpretation of the passages in which you quoted to disprove the Bible using itself were wrong. I made a claim in my last video that said that the epistles line up well with the gospel, and you spent half your video trying to disprove that. You take Paul, Peter, and John and try to show how the epistles that they wrote do not line up with the gospel accounts, and your main point was in the way that they presented Jesus in their epistles. Now, to try to disprove the Bible with the Bible, you have to enter into the world of the Bible. You have to enter into the miraculous and the theology and the language that is used. I know there's a horrible reflection off my glasses. I apologize, but I need them to read. First, you said that Paul has this encounter with Jesus, that he sees Jesus as this bright and shining light on his road to Damascus, on his road to persecute other Christians. And how that doesn't line up with the fact that the gospel says that Jesus came back and was visible and ate with the disciples. The gospels actually say he interacted with 400 or 500 different people after his resurrection. And you say that that cannot be. You also go on to say that Peter also says that Jesus came alive in the spirit after his death. And you point out in the gospels that Jesus says, well, I am here in the flesh. I'm not a spirit. And you say, well, that means that it is inaccurate. The Bible is wrong. It's not coherent. Lastly, you say in 1 John that John says that when we see Jesus again coming, he will be as he is, meaning that he has holes in his hands and a side that is damaged. And how can that work with these other accounts where Jesus is in the spirit or is really bright and shiny? Let me deal with the bright and shiny first. If I can remind you of the time that Jesus took three disciples up to the Mount Transfiguration, the Bible says that Jesus was transfigured there with Moses and Elijah. The disciples recount this story saying that Jesus was this bright and shiny person. He was in his full glory, or at least as much as they could handle at the time. that is within the gospel account, and it's saying that Jesus is all of a sudden coming within his full glory. Given, you don't have to agree with it, but if you are trying to disprove the Bible with the Bible, you have to stay within the frame of the Bible. But you say that that is inconsistent with what Paul saw. Well, Paul saw Jesus in his full glory in heaven, bright and shiny. And if you're following the narrative, Paul comes quite a few years after Jesus died, came back to life, and ascended into heaven. So if Jesus is in heaven, he wouldn't be in his regular form here on earth, would he? To suppose that Jesus is in his regular bodily form in heaven would presuppose that heaven is a physical place that you could go and knock on, like go up to the pearly gates and knock on. But heaven is not a physical place. It's a place where your soul goes. Soul is not a physical thing. So it is well within the reason of the Bible that Paul would see a bright, shiny light and a voice speaking to him. Also, John sees Jesus in Revelation as this very shiny person that, and he uses these words. They're very hard to understand. I mean, he's seeing a vision, things that he is having trouble putting into Greek at the time. He's seeing very similar things to what he would have saw at the Mount of Transfiguration and the thing that Paul would have been blinded by. But 1 John says that when he appears again, we will see him as he was. Well, when Jesus comes back, he won't be in spiritual form anymore. He'll be back on earth. So that means he will be back in physical form. So biblically, it makes sense that when Jesus is in heaven, he's in spirit form. When he's on earth, he's in human form. So really, the epistles do not appear to be inconsistent with the gospel accounts when you understand the true biblical nature of heaven. Also, you quoted 1 Peter, it says that Jesus came alive in the spirit. You have to read the chapter that is written in. That chapter is really talking about Jesus descending into hell and witnessing to the people who died in the flood. Those people would not be in their physical bodies, so as Peter is trying to write this in a way that it makes sense, he's going to talk about Jesus being in spirit form, not in bodily form. Now, you also discredited Paul as being an eyewitness. Well, he wasn't there as Jesus was walking around, but he did have an encounter with Jesus, and he also says that he spent time in the desert to which Jesus had revealed himself to Paul. Now, you can doubt that as much as you want, but within the biblical framework, that is not inconsistent with Paul having knowledge about Jesus. Paul also worked with people who did walk with Jesus, ministered with people who spent a lot of time with Jesus. One more thing. You also said that as far as celibacy, Paul recommending celibacy, you were saying, well, that arose because they thought that Jesus was coming right back and that they should all be dedicated to working for the Lord in the time that they had left. Yep, that's about right. That was the understanding at the time. Now, you quote the verse that says, time being shortened. And the fact that it's been 2,000 years since then would kind of lead one to believe that the time wasn't that shortened. But when you look at the fact that the earth has been around for billions and billions of years, a few thousand is a drop in the bucket. Anyway, I do appreciate your video response and your diligence in doing so. But when you're entering into the biblical framework, you really have to enter into the biblical framework and all of its theology as well. And then you realize, well, it's not so inconsistent, especially when you have proper interpretation and exegesis of the passages. And again, that was the point that I was trying to make to people who call themselves Christians but don't agree with anything that the Bible says because they think the Bible contradicts itself. Jesus was a historical person, and you would have to think with all of these accounts and all of these accounts that line up with one another, as much as eyewitness accounts can line up with one another, there has to be some credence to what it all is saying. You don't have to agree with me, but do understand that logic. Thanks for your time. I know it took a lot of time to do that very well-done video. I like the graphics. I'm interested in what program you're using. And I hope that your viewers get to watch this after they got to see your video, at least to hear my rebuttal for that. Have a great day. God bless.